This Q&A is about rip collars and vests for pig dogs hunting in New Zealand.
Just a little Q&A.
And a few tall stories of me, Clay.
How you doing, Bob? Hey? G'day, boy. G'day, Bob. How you doing? Hey?
John, John.
Old dog and young dog. Anyway, rip collars. It's a bit like a religion, really. Everyone's got their own view on what's the right collar to use or whether to use them. And there definitely is a right time and a wrong time to use rip collars.
If you're just getting into pig hunting, it's a real minefield out there, trying to work out what's the right vest or the right rip collar to put on your dog. You go into a retail outlet and they've got a whole lot of stuff there, and unless the guy behind the counter is a pig hunter that really has been doing it for years and knows what the story is, he's not really going to be able to steer you in the right direction. Also, unless he knows your dog's history and what it does and how it hunts, he's not going to really fit you with the right gear either. So it's really important that you know what your dog's doing in the field when it's hunting. So application is everything. There's no point in putting on like a great big full vest over the dog when in fact the likeliest place it's going to get ripped is in the bum. In fact, you probably don't need anything on if it does that. Old Jim I used to hunt with, the only time he ever got a hook was in his ass. That's when the pig would turn around on him. So finding out the right collar to get the application right for your dog is the difference between failing and succeeding with your dog getting ripped and not. And even all that said and done, nothing is going to ever protect your dog 100%. It's not possible. But you can certainly give it better chances out there in the field by having the right collar. So we'll have a look at some collars and what they do, and I'll talk a bit about them. What do you reckon about that, eh? Is that going to fit on you? Hey? Going to put that on? Probably not. This, believe it or not, was my first attempt many years ago at making my own rip gear out of leather. Now, as you can see, it's gone as hard as a rock. It can hardly fold. The idea was the dog's two front legs went through here, and it was basically a breastplate that went over. And it worked. The dog never got a rip, but it also never got a pig because it couldn't move. It was useless. That'll do, boo. Hey, Bob, is this going to go on you, mate? Probably not. Stiff as a board. I tried everything. I tried putting dubbin in it, and, you know, there probably is a way to do it, but eventually it all cracked. I hand sewed the whole thing with double stitching all around there, and I probably put 20 hours of work into making that, believe it or not. It was a lot of work, and it ended up with just something that I might as well have thrown away. After that, I went to shade cloth, and that was really successful. So I've got an old clip here of my dog Girl. I've actually still got this particular rip gear. I've lent it to a bloke. He has yet to come back to me yet, but it was made out of shade cloth. And the thing I like about shade cloth is it breathes, and also the pig's tusk doesn't bounce off it, and that's what you want with a good rip collar. You want something that doesn't deflect, because when it deflects, well, I'll talk about that later too, but deflection can also cause injury to the dog. So something that's absorbing the tusk and also allows the dog's skin to breathe through it is a good product for rip gear. So we'll have a look at that clip. This is Girl. It's the only time I ever filmed her with this gear on, and this gear did protect her life many times, but in this particular clip she nearly lost her life because I was using the wrong application. It was summertime and it was way too hot, and I had to get it off very quickly, otherwise she would have expired. So we'll go to that clip now and have a look at that. Get this off you, Agil. I fucked up putting this on you, didn't I? I got that wrong this time. Now this here was another one of my clever inventions. What do you reckon, Bob? It's made out of seat belts. I went round the forestry where everybody dumped their cars, and I took all the seat belts off the old cars, and I took them to a canvas maker, and I had this design. And this was designed for my dog, Rope Dog Shark. And that went like that, honey. Well, I can't really show you it myself because I'm not a dog. What I will do is I'll stick it on Bruno and see how it looks. Did I need to make this for the dog? No, it was a waste of time. Get out of the camera, you mongrel. It was a waste of time, really. I was probably being overprotective, and whilst it didn't restrict him, he had plenty of movement, he didn't really need it because he wasn't particularly that hard. And you also had to run a rip collar. But I'll poke it on, for the sake of the video, I'll poke it on Bruno to show you what it looked like. And just for the sake of this video, so you can see how it did look. Probably would have been good in Australia, but not necessarily in New Zealand. I'll switch off and go to Bruno. Well, that's the plate on, but it doesn't have a neck piece, so it wasn't fully complete, and the design wasn't that clever on my part. I could have done better. Trial and error. Enjoying that apple, eh, boy? Mmm. Good tucker. About 500 pounds per square inch, that jaw. You see the size compared to other dogs. 62 kg, Bruno. He's a big boy. How you doing, Tucky? You like those apples too, do you, hey? Right, we'll take that off you, Bruno. Thanks for being a model. Good boy. Come on. Come on, Bruno. Come on. Oh, no, boss. I'll just stay here and eat apples. Bruno, you got your ears on? Good boy. Come on. That's a good dog. Good boy. Come on. In your box, boy. Get in. Good dog. A whole shitload of collars I'm going to talk about. First of all, we'll start off with the leather collar. Now, there's pros and cons to leather collars. As you can see, this one that I used to use has gone into a tight, sort of screwed up, well, it's half its normal size. It should be that size. And the thinner leather collars, that this one has a Velcro, they're handy, easy to snap on, but the downside is that that happens. And that is why I've stopped using this collar, because it's become almost the size of a normal dog collar, so it's pretty much useless. Now, that's a cheap leather collar. A good leather collar, which I've got somewhere here. There we go. It's got two straps that reinforce it. It's got nice, strong buckles that have lasted for years. This is 6 years old, this one. Again, it is starting to gather and narrow there. I would like it wider. But, value for money, I paid $50 for that 6 years ago in 2010, and I'm still using it today on and off. Let's go and talk to a guy. He's a mate down the road. Lives in my caravan, actually. He's a good bastard. His name's Colin, and he's real old school, and he's caught more pigs than you've had hot meals, and he swears by these. So let's see what he's got to say about the leather collar.
Hello, mate. They're just good collars, mate.
Why do you prefer these ones over the other ones?
I just always like them, mate. I've had these sorts of collars all my life.
Yeah, right. Yeah. How old will these be?
Oh, this will be probably, I don't know how many years old.
This one is getting on, isn't it?
Fucking old. Those are my little girl, the bitch, eh? Yeah.
Do you put any oil on to maintain them? Or does the dog's oil on itself for the skin keep them soft?
No, it's just what they got on the neck, I suppose.
Yeah, because I found mine went a bit brittle in times.
These are good, mate. Yeah. Nothing wrong with whatsoever, mate.
Oh,
but
good.
But these things are fucking quite dear.
Yeah, the trouble with these, and everyone says the same thing, is these bloody rings come off, eh?
Look at them. Yeah.
Yeah. The rings on yours have actually weathered well. Mine have dropped off on mine. I've got one of those.
Yeah, good. You know, the old... Always something, always.
Where do you get these collars from, Colin, the leather ones, do you know?
These I got from my brother-in-law.
Oh, yeah?
Up north somewhere, if I can find out, will you?
Can you find out for us?
Yeah.
Right, collars made out of shade cloth. Now, shade cloth is a bloody good product. For pups and smaller dogs, this shade cloth one I have made up as well. And again, it's the same principle. The tusk grabs it every time, doesn't slide or deflect. It's got a couple of buckles. Wee bit of work to put on. I had that custom made for my needs, but it's still lasting today, and it's been whacked around a fair bit, as you can see, but it still works. I rate this stuff. Here's one here. This was on my dog Chun, my main dog, for 6 years. He retired 3 years ago. He caught this pig, which was a big bastard, And as you can see through the collar here, it has not only absorbed it, but the tusk has gone through. Did it go through and get chun? No, it didn't. What it did was, the tusk, it used to go around this way here, so this part went under the dog's chin, as it came up under to hook him in the chin, it grabbed that, went through, but then pulled it away. As it goes through, so it actually deflects it away from the dog. He got one tiny little rip, which was down here. He had another one low somewhere, that one there on his breastplate. It's actually full of holes. It's full of holes, you can see right through it. But the dog never suffered any really bad rips while it was wearing it. The downside, I lost two of these. They have a lace-up set up with a Velcro that goes on the top, and I had pigs rip the laces and they came off. They were expensive. They were made by a canvas maker to my design, and they probably cost me twice as much as you pay for something in the shop. That was the downside, the cost. But I like the concept, and I would use them again, because cost to me is not a factor if it's saving lives. But there are commercial ones out there now that are probably just as good and half as cheap. So we'll talk about some of the commercial ones. Now, I'm in a position where I don't have a sponsor. I've got people that want to sponsor me, but I don't take on sponsors for the simple reason as I then would have to talk bullshit. And that's why I can start talking about products from my own experience and tell you the bad stuff as well, which sponsors can't do, can they? And tough bickies to you guys who are going to hear this, but this is my truth. Hello! Boo! Boo! Sit down! Bob, come! Come on, Bob. Good boy. Sorry. That'll do, Chun Chun. I better go and sort that dog. I'll be right back. Hold on. Hold that thought. Right, sorted that dog out. Let's talk about a few collars that you guys can go and buy. If you want a cheap one, $40 I pay for this. I don't know if it's their retail now, but I paid $40. This is the hunting and fishing one that they have their own. I'll start off with the positives and then I'll talk about the negatives. What's the positive about this? It's cheap. If you think $40 is cheap, I suppose it's still a bit of tin in it. What else? I'm trying to find something good to say. I'll tell you what's good about it is the way it does it. Look at that. Collar on, bang. That's a fast application to the dog and it comes off quick. What else is good about it? It's light, so it's not heavy on the dog. It's got movement. Right, and that's probably about all I can think positive. The negatives? Well, it's a piece of shit as far as lasting. I've had one season out of it, and this is the second one I've already had. Hunting and fishing had to replace the first one. It fell apart on the first hunt. And the guys at Hunting and Fishing that work there are bloody brilliant. They were really awesome. But whoever it is that creates the policy for returning stuff, you need to relook at that, mate, because, or whoever it is, I don't know. Because I took it back to the shop after one hunt, and the guy said, look, we can't exchange it because it's got dog hair all over it. You'll have to clean that off. Well, fuck me, it's a Velcro fastener on it. I started picking the hair off that, and you can imagine how long that took. And then I realised I had the other side to do. After half an hour, I gave up and gave it to my girlfriend, and she started picking it. It took her an hour and a half to get all the dog hair off. So in total, we spent 2 hours cleaning that. 2 hours work. Well, if you're getting paid $20 an hour, there's your dog rip collar already. So anyway, after cleaning it, I gave it back to them, and then it took 3.5 weeks to get another collar. And that time I had to go out and buy one. So not impressed at all by the way their policy is. But again, as I said, the actual people that are working in hunting fishing are fucking brilliant. They're good, all good bastards. I have not yet met a bad one yet. They're all really helpful. Okay, this is the Ridgeline one. These collars, well, they last forever. I've had this one here for about 7 years now, I think. 7 years? No, probably less than that, 5 or 6 years. It, for my way of thinking, it's a wee bit too stiff. It has saved my dog from the odd rip. It didn't cost too much. As you can see, the rings are starting to fall to bits, and this happens on quite a few of them, I've heard. It's quite hard to get this thing, because it slides inside this hair, and I found it quite difficult to get that in on the dog. You'd be pissing around, and if you're an impatient, grumpy old bastard like me, finally you get it on. The dog's moving around, of course,
Positive, well, the collar goes, your tracking collar goes through there, and it stays on pretty good. Positives, well, it's never had a tusk go through it, but then again, I think it's probably a little bit too stiff for my liking. Again, deflection, and I want to talk about that, it's on the dog's neck, the tusk hits it, if it doesn't absorb it, it slides, and that's when it can slide up and come up under the chin. And this one here, it's got a wee bit, it's got a little bit. Now I don't catch that many boars like some guys, eh? I'm in the 80% of hunters that only catch 20% of the pigs, so I didn't catch a hell of a lot of boars with that particular collar, I know that for a fact, so I never really got a true test. There's such a wide variety of products on the New Zealand market, I can't possibly go through all of them. Another good one is KJL Sales over in Blenheim. Now I haven't used them, I've got mates that do. My mate Sean Boyce uses it and says they're bloody good, although he said it wore a bit thin after a while. I know another couple of hunters down south that have actually got them in say they're not bad. They use the same materials as the Game Gear one, and I've got two Game Gear ones, which I've had this one here, which I've now had three good boars with this collar. On Monday we got a really good pig, 134, and it just did, I liked it. I'll tell you what I like about it. I'll go through the positives and the negatives. The positives, it just slaps on so quick, bang. I like that. There's none of that horsing around like there is with the Ridgeline one, where you're trying to bloody get that thing inside there, and then get the buckles on when the dog's moving around. It's simple, goes on, bang, and it stays on and it doesn't come off. I like that. What else do I like about it? I love this. See that? They've actually put in a proper protection for your tracking gear. Now, to buy those tracking gear, those little things, I've seen them sold for $20, $25 that go over your collar. While we're talking about that, here's a wee hack for you. What I use, or I used to use until I started using this, is I use a bit of polythene pipe. I cut it, and then I split it, and stick it over the collar, and then I tape it up, and that protects the GPS unit. But now that I've got this, I won't be using it, because these guys have used their noodle, and they've created that. So I like that. What else do I like? Well, I like the stitching. It's not going to fall apart, like this bastard did. I'm starting to sound like a bloody ad for Game Gear, but honestly, that there is actually, I like that one. It stood up really well to the pig's tusks, and I can't say anything actually bad about this. It's been pretty good, and I've heard a lot of good reviews. Oh, I'll tell you what else also I like about these Game Gear collars. Check out that logo. That's fucking mean. I like that, eh? Looks wicked. Now these guys obviously are pig hunters, because they've thought outside the square. In fact, they've come up with stuff that even GoPro couldn't come up with. When GoPro came out, me as a YouTuber, I went, happy days, here's the perfect camera for filming what I do. But they didn't have a decent dog mount. The one that they came out with cost $100, which I bought, which was a piece of shit. They're just like, the first fence the dog went off on the top, it wiped it off. You could either mount it on top of the dog or underneath the dog. And both ways, underneath the dog, it wobbled around so much. Well, Game Gear in their wisdom solved what GoPro couldn't solve. They incorporated into their rip collar this baby. That's where the GoPro's housed in there. It's not a little light in here, I don't know if you can see that, but it goes in there. So the strap comes right around, Velcro. So in the housing where you've got your GPS collar on there, the GoPro, which goes in that piece there, goes over the top and back underneath, and that's clever in itself, really. So the GoPro's in there, so it's hanging underneath the dog in the front, and it's supported by the actual collar. So that housing behind it, which houses the GPS, also keeps that firm, and it kills two birds with one stone. Innovative thinking on their part. I'm yet to use it myself, because my GoPro's buggered, because I flooded it in the sea. But as soon as I can afford to buy a new one, I will be using it. What I can tell you is I've seen footage used by these, and they are bloody good. So keep an eye out on my channel, because I'll be doing some filming as soon as I can get a new GoPro, and I'll strap this onto Poe. Might better find out all the rabbits and goats and deer she's chasing too, because it'll carry all information. So, nice one, Game Gear. Fire hose is a good product. This is made in Nelson by an outfit called Transport and Marine Covers. And it's just basically made out of fire hose. It's lasted really well. It breathes well. And I like the way the tusk doesn't deflect. it picks it up. Probably not as good as shade cloth, which will catch it every time. Look, that's probably about as far as collars go. What I will say is the most important thing is the right collar for the right dog. You know, if you've got a dog that's constantly getting beaten up around its chest and you're getting the brisket, then a collar's not going to save diddly squat. You're going to need to put a vest on that dog. So go to a vest. If your dog is like old Jim that I used to run, who's a baiting dog, collar's a waste of time on Jim, because the only time he ever got hooked was in the ass when the pig would turn around and peg him in the ass. You don't need a collar. In fact, it's probably more of a hindrance because it's slowing his breathing down. So you have to weigh all these things up. Watch what your dog's doing. Talk to other hunters and what they've found. Probably out of all of these collars that I'm using right now and have used, I'd have to say my pick would be the... It's probably going to have to be these guys, the Game Gear ones, because they're not only making a collar, they're making a protection for my expensive unit, and it's easy to go on. So yeah, these guys get my thumbs up, would be the best out of all of them. And particularly the pig we just got on Monday, it really was good, because Poe is hard, and the couple of pokes it's got, you can see the impression on the side there, like she's got one just there, I don't know if you can see that, where the tusks hit, and it hasn't bugged the collar, it's absorbed it. You can see, I don't know if you can see that actually, but there's one there where it went in, and that's my pick of the lot. But hey, there's just as many other brands out there that I'm not using that are probably equally as good. You might want to find them, but value for money, I reckon this is the one.
How tight should your collar be on your dog? Well, for my way of thinking, I like to be able to get my hand down there so it's tight, not too tight, not too loose. So one hand down there, that will allow for any expansion of the dog's neck, if it's retaining any fluid or just heating up. But you don't want it too loose that it catches sticks and stuff going through the bush, but you also don't want it too tight because that will restrict his breathing, and that's how he cools himself. Plus it will restrict his movement, and you don't want to restrict his movement when he's on a pig. Diego, eh? He's got the big collar because he's a big dog. Remember folks, these are only my views, and not necessarily correct, just the way I do stuff. There's plenty of other ways out there and other products, but this is what I have found to be the best. I hope you've got something out of this clip. Good luck with your dogs. Good luck with finding the right rip collar. Be careful out there. Be good. And if you can't be good,
be careful.
See you later.
Just a little Q&A.
And a few tall stories of me, Clay.